Hey friend, if you are new here, my name is Chris, and a few days ago, I had the opportunity to help a friend refactor some React forms using Formik. I assume more people struggle with writing maintainable React forms, so I thought I should make a video on this. Now, hopefully by the end of the video, you will pick some tips to help you not only create maintainable React forms, but you will also learn how to manage their values and validation state. You will learn how to set up Formik, describe a validation schema, connect Formik to your form, show error messages, handle form submission, and disable buttons for an invalid form. You will also learn how to validate a password to have alphanumeric and special character values. And then we will close off with refactoring the code for maintainability and reusability. I'm going to leave a link to the startup project I'm using in the description, but basically, it has a basic form with some text input component. There is a text input for the first name, the last name, the email, a password, and the Twitter handle. The text input component renders a label, a HTML input, an error exclamation icon, and an error message if one is passed in. The URL input does mostly the same thing as the text input, but with an added prefix prop that displays the URL prefix. It also renders a label, an input that is styled differently, and the error icon and message. There is also a submit button at the end of the form. Before we bring in Formik, I would like to highlight some steps that you should keep in mind when working with Formik. The first step would be to declare the initial values for Formik. The properties should match the name of the input field. The second step is to define the validation schema. You can do this with a plain object, but I prefer to use Yup because it has a built-in validation schema and also a cleaner API. The third step is to pass some props that Formik gives you to your input fields. This is how to set things like unchange event or unblur event for validation. This is also how you define the value prop for the input. The fourth step is to create an onSubmit event function, which you can pass to the form as the fifth step. Now that you have a list of the basic steps, let's jump in and take care of the first step, which is setting up Formik with some initial values. Import Formik as well as Yup from node modules. Of course, you can install them using npm install formik yup. Create the formik object by calling useformik, which takes an object. This object is where you give formik all the form and validation information it needs. Create the initial values property and pass it an object with a list of all your inputs. Each property should match an input field name. So for example, the input field named first name will be mapped to the first name property in the initial values. Same goes for last name, email, password, and the Twitter handle. The default values can be empty strings or maybe something that comes from the local storage. With the int defined, the second step is to add a schema property which takes a yup object. You can define the validation characteristics of each value inside the yup object. We want the first name to be a string and we also want it to be required. You can also pass an error message if the required validation fails. Same thing goes for the last name. The email is also a string that is required, but we also need to make sure that it is a valid email by calling the email function and also passing it an invalid email error message just in case the email is invalid. I'm going to address password in a few minutes since it's more complex. So for now, just do the same thing with the Twitter handle. Of course, it's a string and it's going to be required, and it expects a required error message just in case the user doesn't fill out the field. So at this point, we have a Formik instance, but it's useless because our form and our form inputs don't know about the setup yet. To connect Formik to our form, we need to do three things. We need to set the onChange event with a handleChange function with Formik. We need to set onBlur with handleBlur from Formik as well. This is how Formik knows that this input has been touched, so it can trigger validation. Finally, we need to bind the value, which is currently the empty string we specified, in the initial values object. I'm also setting the error message prop after checking if the field has been touched and if Formik set an error for this particular field. You also need to do this for the last name field, the email field, the password field, and the Twitter handle field. And be mindful to use the correct values when copy-pasting. Before we test the form, we should add an onSubmit handler to it. Formik by default will not call this event if the form is invalid. So just keep this in mind. I have to repeat this. Formik by default will not call this event if the form is invalid. Now to use the function, add an onSubmit event on the form element and pass it formik.handleSubmit. I think at this point we should be able to test the form. If I type in a text field and change my mind to delete the field before jumping to the next, I will get the appropriate error associated to that field. The email field would also throw an error if I try to use an invalid email. I have not validated the password, so nothing happens, but the Twitter handle is also required. Now, if you filled out everything in the form and click the submit button, you should get the values logged to the console. Just like I said, when the form is invalid, we can't submit a form, which means that in this state, the submit button is useless. It is a better experience to the user to disable the button if the form has not been touched or if it is invalid. We can also update this style to reflect that the button is disabled. When we head back to the browser, you should see that the button looks inactive and can't be clicked. Now that we've got validation working, let's jump back to the password field and do something a little more complex. I have to warn you though that you're about to see some regex code, and I didn't write this code from my head. I had to do some Stack Overflow digging to find some answers, so don't feel under any sort of pressure to memorize or know this stuff. That said, first things first, the password should be required. Then we need to have at least one uppercase letter, and if it doesn't, we show an error. The matches function takes a regex value and compares a string to it. We also need to have at least one lowercase letter. It must also have at least one numeric character. It must have at least one special character as well. Finally, the total number of characters must be 8 and above, so we can use the main function to define the minimum as well as the error message. When I head back to the browser and touch the password without filling it, I get an error that it is required. I can also test for the other errors by omitting uppercase letters, lowercase letters, numbers, special characters, or make it less than 8. When I have a correct password, I should be able to submit and get the password in the browser console. If you stopped watching at this point, you should already have all the skills you would need to write forms with Formik. But the inspiration for this video was to make forms maintainable, so let's do some refactoring. The first opportunity to refactor is how we are using the formik props on the field. We are repeating ourselves on each of the field. Luckily, Formik has a getFieldProps that we can use to replace the boilerplate code. We need to do this for the first name field, the last name field, the email field, the password field, and the Twitter handle field. We can confirm in the browser that nothing is broken due to the changes by intentionally entering invalid values. The second opportunity is, instead of using the useFormik hook, we can use a Formik context provider, which is going to make composing the components easier. To use the provider, we need to import it from Formik and also delete the useFormik import since we won't be needing it anymore. The provider's prop has the same shape as the useFormik object, so we just need to copy the objects over and clean it up. Wrap the form with the Formik provider and paste the object. Then format the object to get rid of all the syntax errors. The provider's children prop is a function which Formik passes the Formik object to. Add the function inside the Formik provider and move the form into the function. Now we can test and confirm that nothing is broken and everything still works. One last refactoring step is to make the field components even more composable. I would like to move the getFieldProps and error messages into the components since they are still repeated for each of the field. With the useField hook, we can access Formik from nested components. To use it, first import it from Formik, then in the component, call useField and pass it the props. useField returns an array containing the field information like values and the meta information like touched state and errors. Now we can clean up the component with these two pieces of data. I've also moved the error logic into the component using meta.touched and meta.error. These changes make some of the props we are receiving in this component useless, so go ahead and delete them. Now repeat the same step for the URL input, but leave the prefix. Delete all the props except the label and the prefix. Then create field and metadata from useField and replace all the previous props values with field value and meta value. Now we can go to each of the fields and remove getFieldProps and also remove the error logic. So that means we need to do that for the first name field, the last name field, the email, the password, and the Twitter handle field. Now head back to the browser and test again to confirm that nothing has broken due to the changes. Now that is how you write maintainable React forms using Formik. Thank you so much for sticking around to the end of the video. I hope it was worth your time. Goodbye.